Hello, this is Angela Anderson. Thanks for joining me today for my live show. Today I'm going to be doing a nautical black and white themed painting. For those of you who have never joined me before for one of my live shows, welcome. And please be sure to subscribe and check out my other videos after this. I'll have some links in the iCards for some of my playlists that you can check out. I've got lots of beginner videos and intermediate level too. This one is, despite how it looks, it's pretty easy, especially if you use your the traceable that'll come with it. I've got my husband Mark here today with me. You're sounding a little echoey today. I don't know. But anyhow, so I've got a traceable that is available. You can print it out. Let me see, move it so you can see what it looks like. There we go. It's just from the drawing that I did, and I did record a video for this. Should be up this week. I meant to get it out ahead of time, but the audio did not record on it, so I have a whole video of me drawing with no sound, so it kind of probably didn't help a whole lot. So I'm gonna put some sound to it and get that video out of the drawing of these. But if you don't want to draw them, you don't have to. You can just go to my Thankful Art page on Facebook, and there's a link down in my description. And you can trace it out onto some tracing paper here. I've already pre-painted some 5x7 canvases here. These are actually on wood. That's the only size that I had. But I probably would have done them on canvas too, either way. The wood are kind of nice because they stand up well. But I've pre-painted them with a coat of, and I don't know if I'm going to say this right, anthraquinone blue. It's just a deep, dark blue. If you don't have this blue, don't go run out and buy it. If you've got like ultramarine blue or thalo blue, those will work too. This was just a little shade deeper than those. And so I kind of wanted a navy color. So ultramarine blue, like two coats of that, or of thalo blue, which is a little bit more of a green blue, will work just fine also. Just whatever color you want, honestly. And I actually was spying some Walmart had these little rough wood, like they look like reclaimed wood canvases, and I thought, oh, that'd be so cool with this on it, like the weathered look, and you could use the same colors, maybe use a little bit more of the darker blue in some areas to make it show up against the lighter. It was kind of a gray wood color, so any of those would work great. You do whatever color you want on your backgrounds. I just kind of like that blue, the navy blue and white thing that's kind of popular right now. So my color palette's very limited. Besides the anthraquinone blue, I've got, and this is my palette from before. I actually put out too much paint, so I'm just going to reuse it when I did my sample there. This is a color called cobalt teal, but any kind of aqua green color will work. This can be mixed with like thalo blue and thalo green with some white. Titanium white, this is a color called unbleached titanium, but it can be mixed with a little bit of raw sienna or yellow ochre and white. But I just like it because I use it a lot. It's a great color to have. And then there's the ultramarine blue. I did a test over here to kind of see how close I could get it to the original color. And so I used ultramarine blue and a little bit of burnt umber, and it got it pretty close to this original color. So if you want to get it exactly like this, you can try mixing it. But the first thing I want to do here is show you how to trace on. I traced off three of my little things here, and these were actually voted on in my Thankful Art group. It was really fun. I kind of gave them a choice. I told them that I was doing three or four panels and gave them a choice of different like sea life, and they voted on it in my Thankful Art group on Facebook. And so we chose the seahorse, the coral, which I was really excited about. That wasn't in my original thing. Somebody else came up with that. And then a seashell and the starfish, which starfish are my personal favorite. I just think they're cool. So I traced this out on tracing paper, and I've got some light colored graphite paper. This is comes in packs in your art supply store if you don't have it already. You could probably, if you wanted to, if you don't have this, you could use pastel and mark the back of this with some pastel chalk. and then trace over it, and it should transfer fairly well onto your, it might be a little bit messier than this, but you just put the waxy side down. There's kind of a white side and a shiny side. Put the waxy dull side down, and I'm just going to use a stylus. These are like, gosh, you know, $2 for a pack of four on Amazon, but you can use a pencil too if you want to. I just like them because they don't tear through the paper and they don't mark it up, so I can use it over and over again if I want to. I'm just going to carefully go over my lines here, and it will transfer the pigment onto my thing there. If you're using a light colored background, then use a dark colored transfer paper. And I'm not going to worry about the little dots because those will be easy to figure out. I'm going to set those aside somewhere when they're not in the way. If you preferred, you could use a canvas panel. Something like this would work as well. They have these in all kinds of different sizes. I think I put a link to some regular canvases that were 5 by 7 inches, but these would look great on larger canvases too. Just all kinds of different ways you could use these. So I think, how are we doing on chat, honey?
So far, so good. I've got a couple questions. One is,
okay,
can you use regular chalk?
Yes, absolutely. Yep.
And the other question was, what is the difference between titanium white and unbleached titanium?
Unbleached titanium has just got a little bit of pigment in it. And it is good for if you want to lighten something, but you don't want it to go too bright. Because titanium white will brighten your colors. This will keep them kind of on a more matte, or like not matte, but more of a neutral is what the word I'm looking for, like a neutral color scheme. So if you don't want to brighten them too much, you want to lighten the color, but you don't want to brighten it too much, this is a great color to use for that. But it's basically white plus a little bit of pigment. And I think I've tried it before, and it's like you can use yellow ochre or raw sienna with a little bit of white, or even some burnt umber with a little bit of white, and you'll get a similar color. It's kind of a yellowy white color. You can only get it through Liquitex. The golden color is called Titan Buff, and it's a little bit more transparent. I don't like it as well, but it's a similar color. So Liquitex is the only place you can find it. As far as painting the backgrounds, I just wanted to mention, you can probably see, I kind of left it streaky. I just, when I put my color on, I let the streaks kind of show, and I didn't do two coats because I kind of liked the look of it being a little bit imperfect. And if you wanted to, you could even sand the edges down. Like, this is wood, so this would work great if I wanted to sand the edges down and rough it up and make it look like weathered. Or another option is to use a sea sponge. And I've done this before. These are going to be loud when I set them down on the demo office to be sure that I don't drop them. Grab yourself a sea sponge, wet it down a little bit. This one's a little bit damp. And pick up a little bit of your background color. And you could do this with any color. You could even do it with the teal or something if you wanted a contrasting color. But I just want to deepen up the edges a little bit and show you kind of how that would look. So this one especially is good because it's got a light colored background. And I'm just going to tap that darker color along that edge. See how that'll kind of give it that, I don't know, like a vignette effect. So that's another option to do on your panels if you want to. I'm not going to do all of them that way, but I was looking at a lot of examples, and this was one of the things I saw that looked kind of cool. And I actually have done this with my kids' class several years ago. We did this with seashells, and we used the lighter color aqua, and then we used brown around the edges to darken them up, and it looked really good. So
somebody asked if there's any concern for copyright issues when you're using stuff from Pinterest.
Yes, you definitely need to get the permission of the artist that you're if you're copying something, these are not copies. These are, you know, I've taken ideas and made them my own, and that's perfectly fine. But yeah, you, if you're using a photograph off of something you found in Pinterest, you definitely want to get the artist's, the original artist's permission. Some artists don't mind, like I don't mind if people use things off of my, well, of course my tutorials are meant for copying. As long as you're not printing off my originals and selling them, that's perfectly fine because they're supposed to be used for learning. But some artists really don't like that. So you just kind of have to ask if you can find the information on the original artist. Just ask them and they'll let you know. But I've had students contact me several different times to doing it like school projects, and they wanted to use one of my paintings on my fine art page on my website. And this was before I was even doing YouTube videos. And I always said yes, because I mean, I figure learning from another artist is a great way, especially for kids, to learn to paint. So, and if you're using it for learning purposes, you're definitely not selling it or anything like that. You know, I would think that most artists would be okay with that, but that's just me. All right, let's see. Let's go ahead and just start on this starfish since he's the closest one to us. I'm going to move these a little bit out of the way so I don't get paint on them, because you know me, I'm messy. And I'm going to start out just with a little bit of this cobalt teal. Now, you could use any color you wanted to if you wanted to do, you know, a different color scheme. Just pick, you know, colors that will kind of blend well together. And I'm using a number 2 Robert Simmons titanium. This is a bright. If you don't have it, I've used this one in other videos. This is the number 2. It's the long, regular flat, it's called, I think, or maybe it's called a shader. I'm not sure how they term it, but either one will work fine. The bright will give you a little bit more control. So I'm just going to start from the edges, and I'm just going to pull these long kind of streaky brush strokes down. I'm going to zoom in so you can see more of what I'm doing.
Some people are thinking about putting these into their bathrooms and want to know if the humidity in there will damage them or if you have to do anything special for them.
I would definitely varnish them, but they should be fine as long as they're getting enough air ventilation. My main concern with bathrooms is mold. So, you know, especially if you're using a canvas, wood would actually probably be a little bit better, although it might warp if it got too steamy. But just as long as the canvas is allowed to dry out in between, you have good ventilation in your bathroom, there's no reason not to use. Use these in your bathrooms. They'll be just fine. I have art in my bathroom from paintings that have been in there for a long time. They were just fine. But if it gets super, like if you're like my boys, I don't put my good paintings in my boys' bathroom because it's a small bathroom and they steam it up so bad it takes like 2 hours to dry out. Oh my gosh, there'll be condensation on the walls. It'll be dripping down the walls there and there so long. So yeah, I wouldn't do it in a bathroom like that if you've got kids that are steaming it up. Maybe not, but okay. So I'm really kind of just lightly dry brushing, leaving a little bit of the background color showing through. I don't have a whole lot of paint on my brush here. I'm just picking up a little bit on my tip and I'm just doing these long kind of brush strokes, trying to stay inside the lines and go over the lines a little bit, but we'll go back over those with a little bit of white paint, so it's not that important. I'm just pulling from the outside towards the center point right here, so everything should kind of point towards that middle part of the starfish. Just darkest point, darkest color right along the edge, and then pull toward the center. These side ones are kind of going straight up. So starfish always remind me of my childhood because we grew up in California. I grew up in California, and My grandparents had a little beach place in Mexico where it's, you can't really call it a home. It was more like a trailer on a cliffside in Mexico that we would go. No electricity. At least we had running water, so that was good. But we'd go and spend weeks during the summertime, me and my brother, and go down and climb around on the rocks. That's where I got my nice big scar on my shin. Because I fell and cut my leg to the bone. That was an interesting car ride, an hour to the hospital. And then nobody could speak English, so we were, yeah, that was exciting. But we would catch starfish. There was all kinds of really cool, like, little places for a, you know, 10, 11-year-old kid. It was paradise. We had a great time. Okay, that's good enough. So you can see I'm kind of leaving it nice and streaky, just kind of, I might do a little bit more right in the middle there. Just pulling out from the outside. Good enough. Okay, I'm going to let that dry, and let's go ahead and work on my coral for a little bit. So this time I'm going to switch over to I'm going to grab a bright. You could use I used a number 2 round, but it might be a little bit hard to control for some, so I might suggest using a bright, like this little 2-aught brush here. I'm sorry, I said bright. This is a spotter. It just differs from a liner brush in that I've got all zoomed in. They're both the same thinness, but one's longer than the other. So the liner brush has a little bit longer bristles, and they're a little bit harder to control. So especially for beginners, I recommend using a spotter for stuff like this where we're doing small little lines and details. So let's go ahead and grab some of this color again. This is that turquoise color. Yeah, this is just the perfect width, because even if I press down nice and hard, it's not going to make my lines super thick. That's the main problem with, I think that a lot of beginners have, is just that it's hard. You're concentrating on where you're putting your brush, and then the pressure that you're pressing down is also a factor. So sometimes you might get it in the right place, but then you press down too hard and you've got a big line when you didn't intend for that. So with the coral, I'm just kind of going over. I didn't trace the outline of it. I just traced right down the middle of my drawing. And that way I can kind of go back in here and just sort of do these little choppy lines and just try to kind of keep them about the same width all the way down. The ends of the coral are rounded, so I can set my brush down and get a nice round tip on them. How you doing, hon? You have any
doing
questions
good.
Or anything?
I like the blue in the painting, and we've had our first comment about your nail polish color.
Isn't that cool? I know. It was like I was going for the blue. I had a dark blue, and then I saw this one, and it was like this green, blue, purple. It actually turns purple in certain lights too, and I thought, okay, I gotta go for that one. That one's too cool. Although it did turn out a little bit more green than I intended. I kind of thought it was a little bit more blue, but oh well. Yeah, it was pretty fun. I had to buy a new color. I mean, of course, it's anytime I go down that aisle, it's gonna happen. So that was the, but you know, I didn't have a dark blue, so I needed a new color. Kind of like my paint colors with my acrylic painting. I made the mistake of going on Dick Blick and Golden changed their color palette. They had they changed their color wheel. Golden did. I think that they do it on purpose just to get people to buy new colors, honestly. And of course I fell for it, hook, line, and sinker, because there was a new color called Cadmium Primrose. Can you hand it to me? It's right over there. It's this cadmium primrose. Mm-hmm. It should be right there. It's probably that one. And honestly, it's probably exactly like cadmium light. But it was the color that they recommended on their new color wheel. that one, and like pyrrole orange transparent, which I did have, and then manganese blue, which was I thought was interesting. But they kept ultramarine blue, which was my favorite blue, so that was good at least. I don't know if that even matters to people, but I thought it was interesting. They have all these different color wheels that you can, you know, make combinations of colors, and some are more like modern colors and some are for like classic paintings, you know, that maybe the masters used. So just going through here. I'm trying not to take too long with this. I'm kind of talking, so I need to get hurried up here so it don't take too long. I have no idea how long that the example took me. I didn't even pay attention. So I'm assuming this is going to be about an hour, but it could go longer. There's no telling. It's really not that complicated, though. I mean, it looks more complicated than it is. It's very simply painted, if that makes sense. It's kind of rustic, so I'm not being super careful with my lines. I'm being a little bit deliberately messy about it, and that's just kind of that weathered beachy look that I was going for. So that was a design choice of mine. So if you're like, why is she not being careful with their lines? Those are messy. That's why. Just kind of trying to make it look a little bit more maybe impressionist or something like that. I watched Cinnamon this morning. She was on the Art Sherpa, if you haven't checked out her channel. And she was painting a lighthouse on a beach, which was fun. That was really cool. Kind of a stormy sea. So
yeah, Cinnamon was in right. A little bit earlier.
Was she? Cool.
This chat was zipping by so fast on me.
Yeah, I was kind of in and out. I didn't chat a whole lot. I was watching, but I didn't get to chat the whole time because I was doing other stuff. Okay, so the thing with the coral that I'll just mention is that it's kind of like a tree structure, right? So you start out with the trunk that's a little bit wider at the base, and then it narrows as it goes to the tips. But with coral, the tips are a little bit more rounded, and it's a little bit more like flowy. So your lines aren't as abrupt as a tree might be. It's a little bit, at least this kind of coral. Of course, there's tons of different coral, so there's probably some that are just like a tree. But this one is one that I found a picture of that was a little bit more fluid, I would say. You know, the lines are kind of S shapes, and there's all these kind of Y formations, but they're all like kind of curved, and they're not like straight changes, if that makes sense. So if you're drawing this yourself, just kind of keep that in mind. And like I said, I will have the drawing portion done. I was so bummed. I don't know what happened. I think maybe my program that I used to record my videos updated last week, and I have a feeling that it reset my defaults and changed my mic input or something like that. Must have happened because it didn't have any inputs for mics. I'm glad it happened on that video, though, because it was also set wrong on my live show settings. So y'all wouldn't have had any sound either today unless I'd figured it out. So I was trying to get it done this morning to have one for you, but it just didn't work out. Okay, on this one, I did an extra little couple branches down low because I just felt like it needed it. And I kind of made my like thing here horizontal, gave it a little bit more of a horizontal line. So I'm going to bring out an extra branch or two just off to the side here, just to fill in some of these gap areas. Just add a couple of little nubs on the sides wherever it needs it. And like I said, this brush kind of does all the work. So all you have to do is kind of load it up and just drag it along your line. I hold it like a pencil, kind of close to the silver part. And it might help if you turn your canvas. Since these are small canvases, you can kind of hold them in your hand. Here, it makes it a little bit easier to control. So I find that if you, you know, if you're having difficulty doing a straight line, that if you turn your page or turn your canvas to how you'd maybe normally write, so you've got that, like if you're a right-handed person, you've got that left to right motion where you would, you know, sign your name or something like that, it tends to be easier to make straight lines with in that direction. So don't try to go opposite your writing hand if you're having trouble. That's probably why. A lot of times all you need to do is just flip your canvas. I've got a few more lines here. I'm just basing it in with this, and then I'm going to highlight and do some other colors on top. So this first coat doesn't have to be perfectly perfect. If you're going to get a little too area that's too thick like that, you can use a damp cloth and just gently wipe it off like that. If you catch it while it's wet, and if the background's dry, it should come off just fine. Now be careful if you've just painted your background, even though it's dry, it might not be cured, what's called. So sometimes it takes acrylic paints a couple of days to cure. So just be gentle with it if you're doing that. And especially on this wood, for some reason it doesn't adhere. I put gesso down to help it stick, but it still was wanting to wipe off pretty easily. So just be careful with the wood if you use wood. All right, that's good enough, I think. And honestly, you could leave it like that and be perfectly fine. I like it. I think it looks great. So, you know, if you didn't want to do all the little fancy details, you certainly don't have to. You can make this as simplified as you want. I'm just adding a couple more little spots here. Yeah, that looks good. And of course, if you wanted to get super fancy, you could do some that were kind of crisscrossing. I kind of avoided that. It sort of clutters it. This one's, you know, I'm just trying to kind of keep it visually clean. So let's go ahead and set that aside. Grab our seahorse. He's a fun one. Okay, so I'm going to go back to my number two flat and grab a little bit more of the same color. I'm just going to use this color as my base on all of my paintings here. And I'm just going to kind of fill him in the same way I did the starfish, sort of pulling from the inside down. And on his face, he's got kind of this cheek thing going on. I'm going to go ahead and go over his eye and just pull kind of down his nose there. And then I'm going along each one of his little ridges here. And I'm just going to pull. They've got these stripes along their body. So, and I'm sorry I'm not drawing it today. So that's a whole nother lesson. But it's only like a 20-minute lesson. It really wasn't that hard to draw these. So I apologize if you were wanting me to do that today, but I just don't have time. It would add too much. I'm pulling from both directions here, leaving some streaks in the middle. So just don't put it too much paint on your brush and you should be fine. If you're getting paint going all the way across in a solid blob, that just means that you've got too much paint on your brush. So just wipe a little bit off, load it a little bit lighter, and you should be fine. So I'm just kind of pulling across and sort of stopping just before the end here and then just tapping a little bit. So pull it across and then just tap it if you need to get a little bit extra in there. As I go around, I'm going to turn my brush because these little spokes are going to start going this way. So as I go around, I'm going to kind of keep pulling from straight across. So just keep turning your brush. And we'll add a lot more details, so this doesn't have to be perfect. What were you saying?
Oh, I had a question regarding doing the donation on here.
Oh,
is
right.
Is it a one-time donation or is it a monthly, or how do you know how that works?
Yeah, it's just a one-time. And thank you. There's somebody that's been giving me $20 every month. I don't know who it is, but that is so sweet of you. And it doesn't tell me. That's one of the things that I don't like about the way that this donation works on YouTube, is that it doesn't tell me who it is that's donating. So if you want to let me know, I would appreciate it. Or you can stay anonymous. That's fine too. But I really do appreciate any donations. Every now and then I'll get, you know, a dollar or two, and I just always think, oh, that's so awesome. I wish I could thank that person, you know? So thank you, whoever you are. Hopefully you're watching today. Okay. So that's good. Cause you can see, I've already kind of created the, you know, some shading and things just by the way we're laying on that paint in that streaky way. So, and the tail was kind of pulling toward the inside like that. Okay. So there's that. Let's do the seashell and then we'll get to some of our fun details. So the seashell is kind of the same as the starfish. It's got these kind of diagonal lines that run through it. So I'm just going to come from the insides or the outsides in and pull these like diagonal lines just so that I kind of get a little bit of darkness here. So kind of pull a line there, leave a little tiny space maybe in between. Just, I'm barely loading my brush. There's hardly any paint on it. And I'm following that angle all the way up with my lines. So I never would, you know, I'm not going like this. Although I guess you could, since they have these diagonal lines here, but I think that the main motion is this long diagonal. If you were doing a clam shell, you could pull it from the top down, you know, and do that kind of fan shape. That would be how I would do one of those. Okay, and then this one is kind of going straight across right here. Then this part that opens up, I'm just going to carefully pull from the outside in and sort of stop before I get all the way to the inside. So I want to keep that pretty dark there. And if you get too far, we can go back over it with a little bit of the dark blue. But all of these lines should kind of pull down into that hole. Like they're coming in from this side, they're kind of pulling down. And then as you get toward the middle, they're going straight. And then these ones are pulling in this way. That makes sense. Now I'm just going to grab some of this and just dab it on right here where that bright highlight is going to go. Okay, we're good. It could even be a little bit brighter, go a little bit darker with it. There we go. All right. So like I said, I mean, honestly, I really like these almost, they're almost finished just this way, just with this little bit of detail. So let's go ahead and go back to the starfish now though. I'll show you how we can spruce them up a little bit.
People are commenting on how easy you make it look. So could you make some mistakes or do a little harder?
Make some mistakes. Okay, I'll try. I do. I have to stop and start and think about sometimes, you know, especially when I'm doing leaves or flowers or things, because I do things with my brush that I don't even realize I'm doing, like twist it and things. And I have to stop and slow down and go, oh, okay, wait a minute. I need to tell them that, because that was kind of an important step there. I kind of do it unconsciously. Okay, so I'm going to stick this up here so we can see side by side what we're kind of what we're shooting for. There we go. That works. So there's our little starfish guy. So I'm going to grab a little bit of my white and mix a little bit of this aqua color because I don't want it super bright yet. I'll get there, but I don't want it like right away in your face. And I'm going to maybe use the corner of my brush to just do my little dot spots so that I know kind of where they go. So kind of leaving, you could draw a circle in the middle if you wanted to. That might help you know to kind of avoid that center area, and you're going to kind of start your brush strokes from that middle part down and just kind of brush a highlight right down the center of the starfish. That's going to pop it forward, make it a little bit more dimensional. I'm just setting it down flat and pulling it toward, lifting it. I'm not pulling, moving my hand. I'm just setting my brush down and flicking it. It's a flicking motion. And it lifts because of that pivot. It'll lift right there. So if you kind of get it just close enough in your hand and hold it straight up and down over the canvas, you can kind of get these little dry brush flicks happening pretty easily. So set it down, hold it upright, perpendicular to your canvas, and just flick in the direction that you want it to go. If you get it too bright like that, that's okay. You can go back over it with your lighter color to soften it up a little bit. And then I'm just going to kind of use what's left to kind of do a little bit in the middle there. And that's it. I mean, it's really pretty messy, honestly. It's not. I'm going to use the corner edge of my brush and kind of just go back in here and maybe add a few more little streaks just to kind of maybe soften up some of the blend out a little bit of the transitions between these two a little bit if you need it. But I'm not going to fuss with it too much. That's pretty good. Let's go ahead and grab my spotter again. And I'm going to dip it straight down into my paint. Now, if you want perfect dots, you could go with a fluid acrylic and use the back end of your brush or toothpick and make your dots that way, and you'd have perfect little circles. Now, I'm not patient enough for that. So I'm just going to use my spotter. And this is about the only time that I would tell you to dip into the middle of your paint puddle, but just dip right down in the middle there and grab a little bit of paint off of it onto the tip of your brush, and then you're just going to tap it and make your little circles, shapes. And honestly, they're not really perfect circles, they're just kind of little whatever. You can kind of draw them in a circle if you want to, whatever you want to do. And then I'm going to go along the ridge and just tap, 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 tap a little bit, press down a little harder to get a bigger dot, press down a little bit less to get these smaller dots. I'm being a little bit more careful with this one than I was with my example one. I'm just kind of going fast. We went out of town for a couple of days this week, so it really made, I didn't get this example done until Friday, so yesterday. Or maybe, no, I got it done Thursday, because we were back Thursday, that's right. Okay, there we go. And then, Thursday was the doctor, or the eye doctor, that was, oh, whew. Mark and I both ordered new glasses, and they're going to cost like the price of a small used car. It's terribly expensive. And we even have insurance. It's awful. Our eyes are so bad. The both of us. It's sad that we both have bad eyes. Okay, I'm going to use this unbleached titanium now with the same brush. And I'm going to go along in between here, and I'm going to do some dots with it. Just some random one. I'm not being as careful. I'm just going to kind of dab in some random little dots here and there. You can do a few in the center there. The lighter color just kind of helps it. These white ones will automatically, since they're so bright, they'll automatically look a little closer to you. And then these warmer ones, are these more brownish toned ones, will visually be a little bit farther away. So I'm just tapping, barely touching the tip of my brush down, just tapping some little random dots. And you can look at some reference photos of some real starfish if you want to get pattern ideas. They've, some of them have all kinds of cool colors and dots and stripes. I'm keeping my color scheme all neutral though. I mean, they're all going to be kind of almost like gray, like we did them in grayscale. So these are not like natural colors for these. We're taking artistic license with them. So looking good. And now I'm going to grab a little bit of the white with this. And I still have that other color on it, so it's toned down just a little bit. And I'm going to not outline, but I'm just going to dab little dots and lines all along the outside of my starfish here. And you can kind of go outside the line a little bit if you want to make it look like there's some little suckers sticking out. I don't know what they're called on the starfish. Are they suckers or tentacles? They're not tentacles. I don't know. They're little suction cuppy things. We used to get so many starfish. We'd play with them, those and the anemone, and I actually saw an octopus one time in the ocean. That was really cool. He was a little one, and he was kind of hiding in a deep pool, so we couldn't go and try to play with him. He probably wouldn't have liked that too much anyways. None of these probably liked how we were playing with them. All. And we'd catch crab and that was fun. Okay, so now if I want to, I can go back in with a little bit of the raw sienna and I can add some warmer tones maybe around the outside of some of these dots just to add like a little shadow, maybe a little bit along some of these edges. It's very random. I don't know if that was too much. But just if you want a little bit of that warmer shade, it kind of adds a little something. I don't know what it is, but I forgot to do it on my example actually. So that's good, I think. And then to finish it off, I used a little bit of the background color and just a tiny bit of white to soften it up a little bit and just tapped back in over the top of be a little bit darker than that. Tap back in over the top of some of my whites and just added a few random dots of it here and there just to add another little layer of interest. And that's about it for the starfish. So super simple, very messy kind of impressionist, but I really like how it looks. Like it just from afar, especially if you get farther away, it looks kind of cool. So one down, three to go. Let's grab the coral. He was next on our list. We'll pull this down here.
Well, people are starting to get very anxious about a special guest appearance.
Oh, yes. Okay. So we need to bring in Stickman. And what does he need on him today? I don't know. Does he need a little seashell at his feet? Mm-hmm. He needs a starfish. We'll give him a starfish down here. Like he's on the beach. He's hanging out with the starfish, dude. One thing I didn't mention with the starfish that... it's a pretty messy starfish, but he's got one now. Was that... If you're going to draw it yourself, you start with the center, you make a dot, you do your lines however you want them. Some starfish have more legs than five. And then round out this part especially. They have like webbed, you know, if you think about webbed feet, they have this webbing or, you know, rounded area right here. So that is what gives you that starfish look versus a regular star that would have more sharp edges right there. And then the rounded tips too. So round it here and round it there and you're good to go. Anybody can draw these. They're really easy, easy, easy. So there, Stickman has appeared. He's collecting. He went to France a couple weeks ago and He's back from his French. Maybe he's at the French Riviera. I don't know. He might still be there. He might just be at the beach this time.
No, I think he's down in Brazil for the Olympics.
That's right. He's at the Olympics. Yes, that makes sense. We did watch the opening ceremonies last night. It was pretty cool, I have to say. I'm a fan of the Olympics. We don't watch sports any other time ever, pretty much, but I watch the Olympics. I like gymnastics and all that kind of fun stuff. Diving. Mark's saying I can't watch the diving this year because of the Speedos. But then you can't watch beach volleyball. So. Okay, here we go. I'm going to take this is the Rossiana color, and I'm just going to add a little bit of this here and there. This is just kind of random, wherever you feel like you might want a little pop of this color. You could even do an ombre. I kind of tried that at first with mine, and then I kind of moved away from it. I didn't like it as well, but you could totally do like from a white to blue to yellow at the bottom or something like that, you know, if you wanted to make your coral look like it was fading in color from top to bottom or something. That's all. There, let's grab a little bit of the unbleached titanium, add a little bit of that, and mostly this is going to go along the top edges, like the tips and things. And just add a little bit of brightness. You want to cover up all of my blue, so I'm just going to strategically placing it with the tip of my brush and barely touching it down. A little bit of paint on my brush, just kind of lightly tapping it and drawing in these shapes on my coral, letting it kind of dry brush. Keeping my brush, yeah, my brush is very dry. Oh, got a little something out there. We'll just wipe that off. I'd like to do a whole series of these with the coral. Wouldn't that be pretty on a big canvas with like three different kinds of coral or something? They have those beautiful fan-shaped corals and cone-shaped ones. There's all kinds of different ones that are really, really cool. Okay, I'm just going to pick a side. I guess I'll do my highlight on this side here and just kind of do a little bit on one side there to kind of brighten up. Just going really fast. Don't overthink it. And just kind of. There we go. Good. Now a little bit of white. And I'm going to do the same. Maybe just brighten even fewer areas this time. Just a few little areas. And with this white, I'm also going to do a few little dots. Like, you know how the coral has these little. What are those called? Actually, I don't even know. Like little, it's like pollen almost, like a plant, you know, has these little pods that release their seeds out. I think they're a living organism though. They're kind of almost in between a plant and a living creature, but I think they are considered a living.
Yeah, coral is alive.
Creature. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. They look like a plant, but they're actually not, I don't think. Now, I am sure I'll have somebody tell me. I have watched Discovery Channel and Living Planet, so that's about the extent of my knowledge on sea life. My brother David goes on trips and does snorkeling and all kinds of crazy stuff like that. That's, and I might have, if we had money when we were in our 20s, maybe, but I don't know. The idea of learning that would be, it would be fun though. The closest I ever got was did my Wii game. I had that Wii game called Undersea, whatever. What was that called? I don't know. Under the Ocean.
I don't remember, yeah.
I don't either. It's been a long time, but I used to play that Wii game all the time. And it was like you were diving in
Those things are called polyps.
Polyps, thank
You're
you.
welcome. Google is a wonderful thing.
I know. What did we ever do without Google? We went to the library. We called bars to find out information. If you were my Aunt Marjorie, it's called bars to find out stuff. See, isn't that pretty? It's just adding a little. Oh, I got a little echo there, huh? Just little random dots, kind of going outside the edges. You notice I'm not staying perfectly inside the edges, so I'm letting some of these kind of trail outside so they're a little bit more visible, and that also kind of helps break up that edge a little bit, makes it a little bit more natural looking. I'm being a little bit more careful with this than I was with my example even. I really like how these look. So a few down there, and then I'm going to take a little bit of that dark blue, just like we did on our starfish, and I'm going to just add a few little, especially down here at the base where it'd be more visible since these are thicker, just a few of these little dark blue dots, just in a couple places where they might show up. And there we go. Got some coral. Easy peasy.
So where did you get the canvas again?
These I purchased at a local art store in Little Rock. But I think you can get them online, the wood ones, if you want to. And they are like a smoother texture, you know. They have definitely a different feel. So if you painted this on canvas, you'd get even more of this good texture that I am getting on yours. So splash my water on there. Okay, I need to stop messing with it or I'm gonna make it worse. Okay, so two down. Pretty cute. Fun. Let's go ahead and grab our seashell. This is the one that was a little bit hardest for me because I don't know. It was a little bit tricky. It wasn't hard necessarily, but it was just hard to figure out how to teach it because it had a lot of weird little steps. So I'm going to try to maybe make it a little bit easier for y'all than the way I did mine. So it may not look exactly the same as this one. So I'm going to grab this flat brush again. And I'm going to grab a little bit of the raw sienna color, and I'm going to take it and dry brush over the top, just mainly on this one side here, just to add a little bit of that color and a little bit down here, maybe a tiny bit at the tip. Okay, then I'm going to grab my unbleached titanium. So you notice we're doing a pattern. We're pretty much doing the aqua color, and then the unbleached titanium or the raw sienna, and then we go to the white. So we're kind of working dark to light. So this way I'm going to brighten up that edge even more. If you want, you could use a round brush for this if it's hard for you to get down into these areas there. Just setting it down and flicking, lifting, set it down and pull without moving your hand. So just a very short flicking motion. And I'm going to use the corner of my brush just to kind of tap in a little bit of texture right along that edge. Very random, but brighten it up a little bit. I'm going to do the same thing right here. Now you can use a liner brush for this. You can switch to your liner brush if you want this to be cleaner. Just using the edge of my brush to do this kind of random line right there. That part is really going to look like it's poking out towards us now. All right, now this is the tricky part. I've got these lines in here. If you want to first, what you can do, if you've lost your lines, grab some of your blue, that dark blue from the background, and just starting at your diagonal lines here, kind of darken up your diagonals just a little bit by tapping in a little color. I'm not doing a solid line across. I'm just kind of tapping in just a little suggestion of color. This one is basically a cone shape that's been cut off at every time you just do some diagonal lines and then pull in and shorten, kind of round out your cone at every diagonal line. So, and they're going to get smaller and closer together, these little sections, as you get toward the tip. So it really wasn't that hard to draw. So this is your cone shape here, and then you angle it in like this, and then this part kind of sticks out the side and cuts off part of this. I do it in the drawing portion. I show you how to draw it. So whenever I get that done this week, hopefully, if you want to draw it yourself.
They don't have unbleached white, what can they use again?
You can mix. Here, I'll do it real quick for you. You can mix your... it's probably like, I don't know, 4 parts white to 1 part raw sienna. And then if you want to, it's a little bit more, it's a little bit brighter. So you could take a little tiny bit of burnt sienna or something like that and tone it down just a little bit. But that's about the same color. It's pretty close enough, right? So if you've got like a raw sienna and white, you can just mix that color. It's just, I use it so much that I like to have it pre-mixed because that just saves me time. I can just dip right into it. But yeah, it's not hard. So probably four parts white to 1 part raw sienna is about color. Okay. Oh yes, I was doing the dark blue. Okay, so grab this dark blue. Yeah, I'm gonna do this. I may have to do this again. So I'm gonna tap in some like little dotted lines with this going in this direction. And they can kind of match up a little bit. They don't have to match up perfectly, but they're gonna sort of point toward this tip. So kind of keep them all kind of heading in that direction. These outside lines are a good indicator of the direction too. Kind of follow these outside edges. This section here has these little kind of cross pieces. And then up here there's not as much. Okay, so that'll give us our little outline, and then I'm going to use, let's go ahead and switch to a little bit bigger brush. Let's go to a number 2 round. Now this was a number 2 flat, but I mean, come on, I don't know. The numbering system on brushes are beyond me. So this is about 1/4 inch flat is what I used. And this is close to a liner. It's not quite a liner width, but it's close. I'm going to grab some of this, and I'm going to flatten out my brush a little bit against my palette. And I'm going to use this very sparingly, and I'm going to kind of highlight these in-between sections with these like lines going this way. Yeah, this is a lot easier to teach. Okay. When I did it before, I don't know, it was just harder the way I did it on my example, but this is looking more like what I wanted it to look like, so good going. I always like it when it works out. Okay, so this, we'll do a few like right there. Each of these sections is gonna have these kind of diagonal lines filling up this middle part here. Lots. And you could have used the wider brush. I just think it was, might have been harder to control in these small areas up here. Just barely any paint on my brush. It's barely touching down and dragging just to get a little bit of color in each one of these little sections. And here I think I'm just going to kind of tap a little bit. We get toward the tip here, we'll just tap few little highlights in. I'm going to go back in with this color and just highlight along this one side a little bit, tap in some color, try to define that line a little bit. My paint's getting sticky, so I'm going to add a little bit of water to it, but with my spray bottle, just like grab my spray bottle there and spray my palette down. If they're starting to get a film on them, what you can do is take a little break, spray your palette. You can even put a damp paper towel in, just kind of in a clean area, just set it on there, set another paper plate over the top like that, and stick it into a plastic baggie, like a large 2 gallon bag, or I don't know if these are gallon or 2 gallon bags, but they will re-moisturize your paints and help them stop drying out, because sometimes after a while they kind of form this film and there'll be wet paint underneath, but even if you spray it, it won't penetrate that little hard shell that's happening. So that will help actually get down in there and re-moisturize the outer shell of the acrylics if they haven't dried completely. So that's a little free bonus tip. Okay, there we go. It's looking good. Yeah. Let's go ahead and do that along this side too, just a little bit. Just barely tapping. I'm not trying to outline this carefully. I'm just sort of putting little dabs of paint along this outside edge. And these kind of shells were very kind of prickly along the edges, so there was these little bumps and lumps. So just doing these little dots and dabs will kind of help give that effect. How's it going, hon?
Good. Somebody asked what kind of canvases you're using.
These are wood panels. They're completely wood. They're Baltic birch, I think they were.
Wrong. I think I told people they were canvases, so oops.
They're called Smooth Birch Artist Panels, Art Alternatives. Yeah, this was the place in Little Rock that I got them from. So, but I did cover them with gesso to prime them for sure. You wouldn't want to try to paint straight onto the wood, although you can. I've done it, but it's not ideal. So technically it'll stick better if you put in a little bit of gesso on it. All right, I'm getting there with the shells, almost done. Let's grab the white. I did put a link to canvas panels, just regular canvases. I would have painted these on canvases, honestly, because these are like $5 a piece. So these are like an expensive investment, but I'm going to put these in my boys' bathroom, so it's fine. actually I said I wasn't going to though, huh? Maybe I shouldn't. They might get destroyed in there. They have seashells in their bathroom. But anyhow, I would have done them on canvas if I had canvas panels or canvases. I just didn't happen to have them. I had these and I was too lazy to go to the art store yesterday.
I wonder how many bathrooms have seashells in them.
Probably a few. It's probably a pretty common thing. Okay, I'm using the white now and I'm just going to going in and going to tap in some little white details right along the middle section, and just don't go over your dark areas there. So same areas that you did before with the unbleached titanium. This time we're just using the white to brighten up some of them. Fewer areas, don't overdo it with the white. Some dots, some little, and then at the very top I might really brighten it up along the edge there. I'm kind of leaving this side a little bit darker, maybe. I don't know. You could get real fancy with it and do some shadows if you wanted to. And then I'm going to definitely come along here and do some extra lines, kind of pulling down in, just setting it down and barely set it down and lift almost immediately as you flick it toward the center. There's a lot of flicking going on in this one. A lot of flicking and dabbing. That's what makes it easy, though. It's pretty fun, kind of relaxing. Don't stress out too much. It's best if you go into one of these paintings kind of with less of a preconceived notion. It's not going to look like mine at all, probably, because if I try, well, you look at mine, they don't look the same either. So this kind of, using this kind of techniques, especially, you're going to get very unique results, which is what I like about it, because it's very personalized. It's going to come out very you. You know, your personality is going to come through. You may use a little bit more paint than I do and have a lot thicker looking dabs and, you know, different. That doesn't mean it's bad. That's just, you know, you need to embrace your own style. So I always encourage my students to, you know, yes, use my suggestions, but don't freak out if it doesn't look exactly like mine, because especially when you're first starting out, you're not going to play, you know, if you're playing the piano beside your piano teacher who's played for 30 years, you're certainly not going to sound the same. So, you know, you as a beginner painter aren't going to paint the same as I do naturally. And that's not because you don't have the talent for it. It just means that you haven't practiced as much as I have at it. You haven't developed your own kind of set of skills. So that's what this is all about. It's just kind of giving you some techniques so that you can sort of explore this fun painting adventure on your own. Hopefully. Okay, so we're going to finish with our seahorse. He's a cool little dude. I really liked him. So I am going to grab my unbleached titanium again. And let's go and put in his eye like that. And I'm just going to do a very careful circle here. But I'm not going to fill it in all the way. I'm going to kind of leave a little bit of the undercolor showing through. That'll make it look like there's maybe some highlights going on or something weird going on with him. And then I'm going to use this to kind of carefully sort of tap in some color around his face. Very light pressure. Now you can go switch back to that little, this brush if it's easier for you. How's it going, hun? I hear you typing in there.
Oh, somebody commented that the seahorse is a girl seahorse.
Oh, is it?
And I said, well, the male seahorses carry the kids. But I think that's true.
I think so, too.
But, yeah. You want to Google that just to be sure.
Check your facts.
Don't put that on a test answer at school or anything.
Okay, so he's got this little fin thing that happens right here. I didn't really draw it out very correctly, but... Huh? Emma? No? Shouldn't be. Do I need to zoom in? Okay. Okay. So I'm just outlining very carefully kind of the spines. They have this kind of sloping shape here, and then they have these cross pieces that sort of come across like this. They have this little kind of plaid pattern in their bodies where there's these. And everywhere that these lines happen, there's like a little pokey out part right there, a little spine or something that sticks out. So you can kind of use that as your guide when you're doing your little shapes, right? Then there's a line that kind of comes down from the neck. And I'm going to, let's go ahead and switch to the smaller brush. I think it'll be a little easier. It's going to kind of come and curve down and then join up with the tail. And there's going to be two lines. So maybe we'll do this one first, because it's going to come kind of like this and come in and end right here on the belly. And then this line is going to curve down sort of in between these two. And just come down like this and just dab it all the way down in the tail like that. All right, then I'm gonna put some lines. Whoop, along the outside there. I'm just going to kind of outline, do some cross piece lines here. I don't want to get too detailed with it, because you can get kind of lost in all these little details, although you can get as detailed as you want to. I was just trying to kind of keep it a little bit simplified on mine so that I didn't have to do all the details. If you kind of do the suggestion of some lines here and there, then you don't have to do all of the lines. So I'm just going to kind of clean that up and make sure that's bright enough so that you can see that little spiral, because that's really important. I love any kind of nature that has a natural spiral like that. Like ferns do it and certain animals have it. It's just so, I don't know, I love that. So these seahorses are really cool. They're kind of feisty little dudes too. We've watched them in the aquariums before. They're really cute, chasing each other off and stuff. Kind of like the hummingbirds. We were watching our hummingbirds this morning. We have three hummingbirds fighting for our hummingbird feeder, and they were chasing off a chickadee, thinking he was in on it too. Okay, so that's good. I've added a little bit of highlights along that tail section. These are kind of going in a fan shape. And that's pretty much as much detail as I'm going to do. I'm going to grab a little bit of the raw sienna now, and just add a few streaks of that here in the body, maybe right down the middle section, and a little bit in the tail. Just a few dabs and dots. A little bit in this tail section maybe, a little bit on the face, and that's good. I'll clean that out really well. And grab the white now. And the white's kind of where the magic happens. It kind of brings it all together. Just add that extra little layer. And I almost was going to do this with both white and just white and blue. Do kind of a monochromatic sort of thing. But I needed a little color in it. I just wanted to have a little extra color. So I've added a little bit brighter white to the eyeball. And I'm going to highlight the forehead with a few little dots. Highlight this kind of horn thing that's at the top of his head. He's got spikes all along the back there that can get some attention too. And I'm kind of being deliberately messy again, so I'm not like, my paint's a little bit too wet almost. I'll grab some of that turquoise and go back over that, because I feel like it's too, like, I don't want him to look like he's got hair. He looks like he's got a haircut. He's got a bad mullet. I'm going to go back over that a little bit. Okay, there we go. Shaggy do. All right, let me grab some of the original blue from the background, because we want a little bit of that peeking through. And we'll put a little bit of that. There we go. Just kind of help hide some of the haircut vibe we're getting.
Question came in, if you use acrylic on cloth, do you need to seal it?
Acrylic on cloth? Yes, you use, well, I mean, all canvases are cotton duck fabric. So that's one of the things that I did in college, is we stretched our own canvas and you just use fabric, yeah, and you... we just coated it with gesso. That's kind of what gesso is all about, you need a couple coats of gesso, but I'm just going to put some random dots back in the face there. Okay, he's better. He's got his haircut's gone. But yeah, the gesso is just that sealer. You know, you'll definitely need to use that on your fabric. If you want the fabric to show through, you can use a fabric medium. So like if you were using a printed fabric or like a tote bag or something like that, where you weren't going to paint the whole thing, you just add a fabric medium or buy a fabric paint to use to paint with. And you can do pretty much all the same techniques. You just need to use the right kind of paint, because acrylic paints will be okay, but they wouldn't wash well on fabric. They're flexible to a point, but the fabric medium makes them even more flexible so that they just makes them better able to stick to the fabric. Okay, so let's keep doing. I'm just going to add some dots. I'm kind of keeping them horizontal. So set my brush, hold my brush kind of to the side so that my dots, when I make them, are a little bit more in this direction. Keep that kind of horizontal feeling along the body. And each one of these little sections where the cross right here is going to have an extra bright highlight. So make sure that you pay attention to that. Each one of those sections right there where this line meets this line, there should be like a little raised dot there. So make sure you make a dot on those spots.
So nobody's asked this, but how would you make this seahorse kind of boho?
Boho seahorse. I don't know. That's beyond my pay grade. Boho seahorse. Well, he could have a little garland of flowers. He could be wearing, well, honestly, if you put it on a hemp or a, I'm not kidding, put it on a hemp fabric or a burlap canvas, that would be way more boho than this. So not that hard, really. I'm going to add a few more like little motiony details to his little outline here. And then, of course, we need his eyeballs, so I'm going to grab some of that dark blue. I may have too much white on my brush to grab it. Just dipping it in. There we go. Come on. It's getting sticky. I'm going to put in my eyeball is kind of a slanted, like straight up and down. And then use this color to kind of do a little outline along the outside of his face. You can add a little details here and there, maybe a few stripes in his body. Tail. Just a little bit more of this color. All right, I think we're good. He looks pretty good. This one's like looking down at us. This one's looking straight ahead. So you can adjust the placement of the dot to suit yourself. This one is placed a little bit farther down on the eye. I'll clean it up just a little bit. There we go. Cute. Okay, I think we're done. So how long was that? Hour and 15, not bad. Not bad for four canvases. Let's pull them all together so you can see them all finished. Oops, let me zoom back out. There we go. Thank you guys so much for watching today. This has been really fun for me. Hope you've enjoyed it too if you're watching the replay. Thank you. And I do these live shows every Saturday at 2 p.m. If you want to catch one, you can ask questions and interact with the other people watching. There's all kinds of really fun chat going on during these shows. One of the bad things about having to teach the classes because I missed out on all the fun chat. So, oh yes, be sure to vote for your favorite. I don't know. I just kind of am curious, you know. No reason, just for fun. Vote for your favorite coral, starfish, seashell, and seahorse. So thank you so much for watching. I will see you next week. Be sure to check out my other videos and be sure to subscribe if you haven't already. Leave a comment. Like the video. Love it. That helps me out so much, especially if you will share it on your social media, pin it or put it on Facebook or anything like that. Really helps me a lot. And I will see you next week. Thanks. Bye.